Next on Currents News, UN Ambassador Nikki Haley handing in her resignation today, and President Trump was by her side during the public announcement. Hurricane Michael is spinning itself closer to Florida's Gulf Coast. Troops are getting ready to roll in to help while residents are getting ready to get out. Plus, thousands of pilgrims and church leaders gathering in Brooklyn's King Theater for a major evangelization event, the Magnificat. We have team coverage. And North Korea's Kim Jong-un set to extend an invitation to Pope Francis. A busy day of news, and it starts right now. Good evening, everyone. I'm Liz Faublas. A big surprise today at the White House. UN Ambassador Nikki Haley facing the cameras with President Trump to tell the world she's leaving her post. Karen Kafa reports the latest from Washington.
It has been an honor of a lifetime.
A surprising announcement in the Oval Office. UN Ambassador Nikki Haley resigning.
We're all happy for you in one way, but we hate to lose. Hopefully you'll be coming back at some point.
Haley will leave her post at the end of the year. The president says Haley told him 6 months ago she sought a break. However, a source familiar with the situation told CNN Haley notified Trump about her decision only last week. The announcement caught some top Trump administration officials off guard, some asking, why now? 4 weeks before the midterms and the day Brett Kavanaugh took the bench at the Supreme Court after a bitter confirmation battle. The former South Carolina governor, well-liked at the UN while navigating the Trump shift in U.S. foreign policy.
The Secretary General wishes to express his deep appreciation for the excellent cooperation and support that Ambassador Haley has always demonstrated.
And seen as a moderating voice.
Nikki Haley was generally seen as one of the grown-ups in the Trump administration, somebody who was a very skillful politician, able to get along with President Trump, but also to cultivate a separate identity.
Haley had praise for her boss.
Now the United States is respected. Countries may not like what we do, but they respect what we do. They know that if we say we're going to do something, we follow it through.
And quieted any speculation about a 2020 White House bid.
No, I'm not running for 2020. I can promise you what I'll be doing is campaigning for this one.
President Trump says he'll name a successor within 2 to 3 weeks. In Washington, Karen Kafa, Currents News.
Brett Kavanaugh completed his first day as a Supreme Court justice today. Following a swearing-in ceremony at the White House last night, he took the bench this morning in what is expected to be a new era for the court. After weeks of polarizing confirmation hearings, Justice Kavanaugh says he's ready to serve the nation.
I will seek to be a force for stability and unity. My goal is to be a great justice for all Americans and for all of America.
During his first day hearing oral arguments, Justice Kavanaugh asked a lot of questions. The court heard two cases about long prison sentences that under federal law are intended to get repeat offenders off the streets. Catholics from around the world flocked to the Brooklyn Diocese this weekend with one goal in mind, boosting the faith at the Magnificat Day of Thanksgiving. The special event attracted Bishop Nicholas DiMarzio and other top church leaders and thousands of pilgrims. Currents News' Katie Engeser begins our team coverage.
It was a major evangelization event, and it attracted thousands.
It truly is a day that we magnify the Lord as Magnificat.
Which gives even greater meaning to the Magnificat Day of Thanksgiving. The Magnificat is a spiritual guide known to churchgoers around the world, helping Catholics follow daily mass and develop an enriched prayer life. The occasion celebrated the silver jubilee of the publication's mission of evangelization.
A way to give people the tools they need to be firm in their faith, because they won't evangelize unless they feel good about their faith.
The anniversary ceremony was put together by the Magnificat family in partnership with the Brooklyn Diocese. Bishop DiMarzio welcomed pilgrims to the King's Theater in Flatbush.
We are here to praise God.
Joining Bishop DiMarzio were the Pope's U.S. Ambassador, Archbishop Christoph Pierre, and Boston's Cardinal Sean O'Malley.
We learn to be a people of faith the way we learn a language, by being part of a community that speaks that language.
They talked about evangelizing the faith and led the pilgrims in the worship of the Blessed Sacrament. Father Sebastian White is the Magnificat's editor-in-chief.
So today's celebration, I believe, communicates in a powerful way. The Catholic faith is working, right? It's effective in the world. It's inspiring to people.
Hallelujah. Adding to the Jubilee, a symphony orchestra played Catholic musical masterpieces, and an actress performed spiritually inspiring scenes.
Are we to fear God, or rather love Him?
A highlight of the day was the opportunity to venerate relics of the Little Flower, Saint Therese of Lisieux, and her parents. Ted Musco is the leader of the evangelization team in the Brooklyn Diocese.
So it's a wonderful opportunity for us here in the diocese to be able to not only hear these wonderful talks, but also to be able to internalize them and then share with others what we really feel about our love for Jesus Christ.
In Flatbush, Katie Angusser, Currents News.
As Katie reported, the Magnificat's Day of Thanksgiving attracted many pilgrims to Brooklyn's King's Theater, and to learn what motivated them to attend, Currents News Tim Harfman spoke with several.
For worshipers, this day-long event of prayer, reflection, and music allowed them to unite as a church.
I wish I can live every day like today, you know, because it's a breathtaking for me.
It blew me away. Everybody, and the feeling in the room, the energy in the room was incredible.
This celebration also gave Magnificat readers the chance to express their devotion for the sacred literature.
I just love the Magnificat, and I just love the message that it promotes.
I have been a part of the Magnificat family practically for all 25 years of its existence. And I couldn't think of a better way to celebrate this anniversary.
It's just a part of my daily prayer life and my formation as a Catholic.
Many worshipers called this event a spiritual boost at a time when the church is facing the clergy sex abuse crisis.
Very uplifting. I think it's what we need right now, especially in our country. I loved every minute of it.
I think it's touched the heart and mind of so many people, and through all of the difficulties that we're going through right now, this is kind of a B12 shot that we needed. And it reassures us of the presence of God guiding His church consistently and constantly.
One lay Catholic and mother saw the event as a way to build the future of the church through religious vocations.
I have a daughter in formation to become a sister. And so for me, it's encouraging to see people still supporting vocation, supporting our church, supporting our priests and religious.
And it was a day for all to support the Magnificat and strengthen the faith. In Flatbush, Tim Harfman, Currents News.
Boston's Cardinal Sean O'Malley was one of the headliners at the Magnificat event, and he talked about how the event is an opportunity to spread God's message, especially during troubling times for the church.
It's very, very encouraging. It's a great source of joy, and it reminds us that we need to focus on our values and focus on our interior life if we're going to be able to be faithful to our mission in the world. Magnificat has given us such a great service of promoting a liturgical spirituality and using a beauty as a way of helping people to glimpse God's beauty and to find meaning in their faith.
The Magnificat is published each month in print and online. And for more information, go to us.magnificat.net. The Archbishop who criticized the Pope over the handling of the Theodore McCarrick case is drawing criticism. Now a top church official, Cardinal Mark Ouellette, has written a letter to Vigano accusing him of, quote, an unjustified attack on the Pope that is an open and scandalous rebellion. He told Vigano, repent of your revolt. Archbishop Carlo Maria Vigano claimed Francis relaxed sanctions against the disgraced ex-cardinal. He also called on the Holy Father to resign. The pontiff is stepping up the investigation into the McCarrick case. Over the weekend, Francis is ordering all Vatican files related to McCarrick be examined. The Pope sentenced McCarrick to a life of prayer and penance after allegations of sexual misconduct were found credible. The Pope's top abuse investigator says the scandal is causing a lot of pain. Archbishop Charles Scicluna making the comments at the Synod at the Vatican.
It's a very important moment for us all because it's certainly one of the fruits I see is that it's going to make us really, really humble. Because there's no other way to humility except through humiliation.
Shakluna also says the abuse crisis is definitely present at the Synod, especially in the halls and at breaks. National correspondent for The Tablet and Crux, Christopher White, is in Rome covering it all, and he joins us now. Chris, Pope Francis ordering a more thorough investigation into the McCarrick case. Why did the Vatican decide to do this now? How long could this examination even take?
That's right, Liz. We're now a month into the McCarrick saga post-Ireland, in which the Pope really received all these allegations. And I think the main thing that's driving this and dragging it on, in fact, is the fact that the Vatican moves very slowly. And so internally, what had to happen is a review of files had to take place inside what's known as the Congregation of Bishops, which is the body that oversees all the bishops around the world, and move that over to the Vatican Secretary of State, where the formal sort of investigation will occur. And so what we've seen is just the slow machinations of the Vatican bureaucracy. But the fact that we are seeing something at all is signs of progress.
And another big story you're following for us, a top-ranking Vatican cardinal, Mark Ouellette, firing off a letter denouncing the recent accusations from Archbishop Carlos Maria Vigano, who accused the Pope and others at the Holy See of mishandling the McCarrick scandal. Was the cardinal answering for the Pope?
Well, I think it's unfair to say that he was answering for the Pope, but he was certainly answering with the Pope's permission. He states fairly, very clearly in his three-page letter that he's writing this with papal approval. And I think because this cardinal himself, Cardinal Ouellette, was under fire from Vigano, he felt personally attacked and wanted to respond not only to clear his name, but to clear the office of all the bishops that he represents, and of course the Pope himself, who is his boss.
Well, Christopher, as we've mentioned, this youth summit is being held against the backdrop of the global clergy abuse crisis. It's been almost a week since the Synod began, though. How have the world's bishops handled the topic so far?
Liz, what we've seen now, it's very clear that sex abuse is an important and critical part of the discussions underway here at the Synod. Now, the question isn't, will sex abuse be addressed? That's very clear that it will be. The question is, how much? How much is it front and center in the final document? And so there are some bishops that think that it really should take a substantial portion of this final document's attention. And others say, you know, it can't overshadow the entire outcome document itself.
Today, you got a look at the first reports from the Synod working groups. What themes have emerged from all that?
Well, Liz, sex abuse is number one among them. I mean, it's certainly one major theme, but it's not the only theme. But these working documents did provide sort of an x-ray of the other types of conversations that are being had. And a major theme is migration. One thing that is uniting bishops from around the world is the fact that many migrants are young people searching for the home, for a home, and the church is, in a sense, the best body in the world to respond to them. We're talking about technology. Bishops are recognizing the fact that it's a critical part of engaging with young people, and they're asking themselves how they can better use it. So, in fact, one of the groups said, you know, each week during the Synod, we not only need to release a report that's full of words, but we need to release pictures. And so I think that's a very practical way that we're seeing the bishops talk about this. And then, of course, issues of sex as well, you know, how the church can bring young people to a better understanding of its teachings.
All right, Christopher, what more can we expect in the coming days in the time we have left?
Well, we're going to have, more discussions. We're going to see the bishops take these working group discussions and try to draft some sort of outcome document. So we'll probably have a draft document in about another week. And then, you know, this will all sort of reach a crescendo in a final document that then the Pope will take and, you know, take into consideration and eventually lead into his own document, likely known as an apostolic exhortation on how the church engages young people.
All right, Chris, thank you. Great report from you, as always.
Thanks, Liz.
There's a lot more news headed your way. The dictator of North Korea, Kim Jong-un, promises the Pope a warm welcome if he comes to the country's capital. Hurricane Michael is bearing down on Florida's Gulf Coast. The storm is expected to slam ashore in a matter of hours. A big event set for this Sunday, Pope Francis will canonize new saints. The ceremony is in connection with the Youth Summit. The pride of Italian-American culture is displayed on Fifth Avenue. Bishop DiMarzio is part of the Columbus Day Parade. And do you have a story idea, something happening in your parish we should know about? We want to hear from you. Keep this email handy, newstips@desalesmedia.org. We'll be right back. The winds and waves of Hurricane Michael pounding a large cruise ship stuck in the ocean off of Cuba. The storm, now a Category 3, is forecast to make landfall tomorrow afternoon, sending a storm surge onto the low-lying areas. Officials are telling residents to get out while they can. Thousands of National Guard troops are being mobilized ahead of the strengthening storm's landfall. Natasha Chen has the latest on this fast-breaking story.
As Hurricane Michael churns toward the Gulf Coast, Florida's Governor Rick Scott issued a stark warning.
The storm can kill you, and you cannot take it lightly.
The storm is gaining strength as it barrels through warm Gulf waters, on course to make landfall along the Florida Panhandle Wednesday.
And as it grows stronger, we can expect it to make landfall as a major Category 3 storm.
It's threatening a huge 300-mile chunk of coastline from Florida to Alabama.
I lost my home from Hurricane Opal. And this is supposed to be really bad like that, so I'm not looking forward to it.
In some areas like Panama City Beach, officials are warning people to get out while there's still time.
You need to be on the road today, this morning, and evacuating.
Michael could bring storm surges of up to 12 feet, heavy rain and flooding, and high winds that could cause widespread power outages.
You will see damage to infrastructure. You will see power outages.
Empty store shelves are a common sight across the region as residents stock up on supplies.
We opened at 6 by 6:15. We sold out of every generator we had.
Thousands of National Guardsmen have been activated, and hundreds of Florida state troopers are heading to threatened areas. The White House says it's monitoring the storm, and federal officials are preparing for the worst.
We are very well prepared. FEMA's ready. We're all ready.
In Panama City Beach, Florida, I'm Natasha Chen reporting.
Kim Jong-un is promising Pope Francis a warm welcome if he visits North Korea. That's part of the message South Korean President Moon Jae-in will deliver to the Holy Father when they meet at the Vatican on October 18th. A Korean spokesman shared parts of the communication where Kim said if Francis goes to Pyongyang, Kim would ensure a great reception. The Pope visited South Korea in 2014. A big highlight of the youth summit now underway at the Vatican will take place this Sunday. The Pope will lead the canonizations of two modern saints that have had major roles in recent church history. Melissa Butts reports.
On Sunday, October 14th, Pope Francis will preside over the most awaited canonizations of this year, Pope Paul VI and Monsignor Oscar Romero. The ceremony will begin at 10 a.m. local time in the Vatican and will be particularly special because of the context. Church representatives participating in the Youth Synod will be in attendance. Pope Francis will canonize the Pope, who faced both new and old challenges. He helped clarify the relationship of authority between the pontiff and the bishops, highlighted the role of the laity, confronted the doubts raised by the sexual revolution, and moreover, he was the first pontiff to travel in order to be seen outside of Italy. The other anticipated canonization is that of Monsignor Oscar Romero. He's a symbol of the church not allowing itself to be bound by its own benefactors. Romero raised his voice to defend those who are politically persecuted and went against the norm. He was misunderstood by some bishops and ultimately assassinated. That day, Pope Francis will canonize another five saints. They are Italian Nuncio Suprizio, who died at 19, priests Vincenzo Romano and Francesco Spinelli, and two nuns, Maria Caterina Casper and Bolivian Nazaria Ignacia of St. Teresa of Avila. At the Vatican, Melissa Butts, Currents News.
The U.S. Bishops' Conference is speaking out about the Trump administration's new cap on refugees. The president limited the number for this fiscal year at 30,000, created the lowest refugee ceiling in the 38-year history of the program. The U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops released a statement in response to the cap saying, quote, "We believe it is our duty to welcome and help those who are persecuted, including children and religious minorities." Still to come on Currents News. the Columbus Day Parade. Bishop DiMarzio joins the big crowds on Fifth Avenue. And the Green Art Show at Blessed Sacrament Parish. We'll be right back. Thousands gathered in New York City yesterday to celebrate the 74th annual Columbus Day Parade. The streets were lined with Italian families celebrating the contributions their ancestors made to the United States. Current News' Michelle Powers has that report.
Trumpets keep the beat as 35,000 people march. Fifth Avenue, the stage, red, white, and green, the banner.
A lot of pride today, a lot of tradition.
Deborah from Napoli watches a lot of parades, but she's partial to this one. She's Italian, born and bred, just like these two. The heart of Midtown shutting down for this long-standing New York City tradition. Italian pride pulsing through. Now in its 74th year, organizers say the Columbus Day Parade is the largest celebration of Italian-American culture. With a front row seat to the floats and festivities, the crowd of clergy in front of St. Patrick's Cathedral. Some proud Italians themselves.
I mean, I think the Italians in America, we did so much to build this country. We helped build the country.
Family meals and spending time together. It's the way Jesus did a lot of his work and a lot of his ministry, and Italians get it.
And others, Italian by association.
Well, about 60 pounds that I'm carrying around. There's a joy, there's a real joy in their unity, and we need that.
Last year, the festivities fell during a time where there was a lot of controversy surrounding the statue of Christopher Columbus in Columbus Circle and whether or not it should remain there because of Columbus's contested treatment of Native Americans. Ultimately, the city decided it should stay. As he walked along Fifth Avenue, Governor Andrew Cuomo nominated the statue to the National Register of Historic Places.
Very religious man. He was the Third Order Franciscan. He recited the office every day. He had his men pray each day on the ship. So I think this was a real man of faith.
This year, the focus recentered around a show of Italian-American pride, a parade you don't have to be Italian to appreciate. Michelle Powers, Currents News.
Finally tonight, one of the parishes in our area is showing off its unique artwork. Our Lady of Blessed Sacrament in Bayside, Queens, hosted its second annual art show where parishioners displayed their masterpieces. The event featured everything from drawings and landscape photos to homemade arts and crafts, all created from recycled materials. The parish's green team, whose purpose is to further promote the Holy Father's encyclical Laudato Si, organized this event. That is Currents News. I'm Liz Faublas. Thank you so much for joining us because we are putting your faith in the news. I hope to see you again next time.